So Gail did a great job of talking about setting up workflows and all the things to take into consideration and paying attention to detail and keeping track of those details. So I'm not going to do that. I'm going to talk about the workflow at History of Art, and I know that this is going to go over some things that you probably won't encounter, but hopefully the examples that are shown here might make you think of things that would be applicable to your own units. So, and I want to say again that the fish that I showed this morning, they were not publication quality fish. They were just examples to tie, you know, my past to fish. So, in working at History of Art, we encounter all types of formats. A lot of film, we do slide scanning, a lot of batch scanning of slides. We have a Nikon 5000 with a back here. In fact, we have we had at one time five of them, and we had them running with students at workstations, and we had 10 students hired, and they were going like all day long. We discovered after a while that wasn't the best method because we weren't achieving the best results that our faculty wanted us to. So after years, we revamped that system, and now we have people with professional level post-process imaging skills to correct problems with our slides and to work with the archival material that we have. But the bulk of our collection is 35 millimeter slides. We also capture images from books, archival material, as I talked about this morning, lantern slides, scrolls, and I'm just going to flip through some things just to give you an idea of the collection that we have. So that was the slide room, which we actually are getting rid of the slide room, and we're going to keep just the unique items that we can't get from anywhere else and put those into compact storage. And this is our archive, consisting mostly of photographs. And this gives you an indication of our imaging workstations. We have two Epson V700 scanners, and those handle up to 4x5 transparencies, and they handle larger size without mounts. And we also have 5,000 scanners, and then we also have an oversized flatbed scanner, which handles our lantern slides and then transparencies up to any size, and it has a custom focus. So depth of field is not an issue, so we don't need holders for anything that's scanned on that unit. We use a copy stand for most of the work that we do. This is one of our technicians, John Hensel, who is photographing a scroll. And he, for this, devised a system where he's capturing segments of the scroll and then stitching together portions of that for the final. It's far too big to have the whole thing stitched together and have it be a workable file. So this, at the highest level, is our workflow. The order. Regardless of what kind of format it is, whether it's a rush order, whether it comes from faculty, or if it comes from outside of our department, the order comes in, it's logged, and it's registered with our system. It goes to imaging first. This is a recent change we made within the past 6 months. There were times before where most of the time it went to cataloging, and then occasionally it went to imaging. And this change seems to be working really well for us. And it's simply that happened just because of preference of the people that were in the positions. So that's something that comes into consideration as well as Gil talked about. Sure.
Oh, okay.
So that's good. This is our workflow. delivery, whether they're rush items or if they're something for publication. They go to multiple places at once. So they do a special delivery before they go on a cataloging, and they simultaneously go to cataloging. The image files drop to UMDL at the same time, within the same day. It also goes into our file storage and our server system. We have we lease three terabytes of server space from the college, and that ensures that we have all of our files backed up. We haven't relied on external drives in a while, and that's something that we're encouraging the museums to switch over to as well. And that's one of the things I failed to mention this morning that came out of that report, is that LSNA is now going to be providing server space for the museums, which is great. And if you're working on projects that are grant funded, I would encourage you to write leasing of server space if your IT department provides that service into the grant as a recurring cost. You know, you could do the startup cost of the grant, and then that would be something you build into your budget later on. Because I think it's important to keep those things on central server spaces where people who you know, have a professional experience in backing that up and making sure that it's taken care of can handle that. We've seen some problems with, you know, external drives or with, you know, other types of media. So there's an exchange of information between cataloging and UODL, and then the item is closed at a certain point in time. So you can see it's not quite linear. If I stand over here, can you still hear me? Okay. And for the purpose of the rest of this talk, I'm going to switch that over to a column view on the left and then break out each one of these. So the order comes in, and you can see that our orders come from a variety of different places. We have things that come from faculty. They can be for teaching or publication. They can be for current classes or for collection development, for anything in the future or something that they think would be useful just in the field of study. They can be collection development general. In the closing down of our slide collection, that's something that fits into that category. Collection development special projects, where archival material or non-archival material gets digitized. Non-archival material, an example of that would be, we had slide distribution projects where photographers from History of Art went all over the world and photographed.